Each summer, the ABWM does a White Cross project to support some worthy cause. A couple of years ago, we asked for donations to help the eye clinic in Haiti purchase a new van so they continued to reach patients that needed care in remote areas. We raised $2,000, and that money, along with many other donations, allowed them to reach their goal, and they were able to buy their much-needed vehicle. For many years, the Dorcas Rose Hill Circle collected items and put together school kits and health kits for Church World Service that were sent around the world to people in need of these necessary items. Our ABWM supports Church World Service on Mother's Day each year when we hold our Blanket Sunday collection. So this summer, when I read about a new project that Church World Service had begun, we decided to try something new. Church World Service has recognized the great need that many girls and women are experiencing with period poverty, and they have begun a new kit project, Period Packs. There are 9 items that they decided were a necessity to have when that need arises each month. These 9 items are placed in a 1-gallon plastic bag and distributed all over the world where they are needed. You can go on the Church World Service website and read stories about this great need, because so many girls and women do not have these important supplies each month, and they are impacted in many ways. Their mental health suffers. They feel shame. Many girls cannot attend school without these supplies, and in many cultures, this blood is considered dirty, and thus the girl is not accepted. All communities are affected by this, but the black and brown communities are especially impacted, as are the homeless, single mothers, low-income families, women without a car to go to a store to purchase these supplies. It is reported that 1 in 4 girls in the United States miss school because of the inability to properly care for themselves during this time. It was reported that women in prison are not given these necessities. They have to buy them. We have all heard this summer about the devastating floods and severe weather across the U.S. When your house and everything in it is destroyed by fire or floods, women still have to handle this monthly issue. I'm sure that we could name many more reasons why this is such a huge ongoing problem in our world every day. We gave our congregation a list of items that they could donate, and of course we asked for cash donations. Many of these items were very specific, and the most efficient way to gather them was to order in bulk. Thanks to the generosity of all of you, we received many of these items and over $850 in cash. We were able to put together 73 kits. Marie, Pat, and I got together on Tuesday night and assembled them, and they are ready to be shipped. There were a few open boxes of items that we had left over, and I planned to donate them to the Allentown High School. The nurse there told me that they would be so grateful to accept them, as she has girls come to her every day in need. These necessities become very expensive when you realize how much of them are used each and every month. Thankfully, we could purchase some from Costco and Amazon. So now let us dedicate these items. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless these 73 kits and the girls and women that will receive them wherever they may be needed. Particularly bless the people that donated to make this project such a success. Let us be more aware of this particular need and the huge problems that arise when access to these items isn't available. Let us remember how truly fortunate we are to live in a country that cares about others in need, whatever that need may be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Once again, good morning to everybody. I know Baptist Women's Sunday. The theme scripture for this Sunday is Joshua 1, 1 through 9. It's all about courage. Joshua is installed as a leader. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the laws my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the laws always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will have prosperity and be successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. The word of the Lord.
This is our favorite time at church, right?
Yep.
Our favorite time. So when Octavia asks, we can't say no, can we, ladies?
No.
She is our youngest American Baptist girl, but I think she'll be a woman in no time flat before we close our eyes. She'll be right with us, right? Yep, okay. Well, our whole theme is about being strong and being courageous. So tell me, is there anything you're afraid of?
Spiders?
She's daddy's little girl, isn't she? Anything else you're afraid of?
Bugs.
Bugs? All kinds of bugs? Really? Well, you do realize that they're all smaller than you, right?
Yeah.
So why are you afraid of them?
Because they're smaller than me.
Okay. Well, what do you do when you find something that you're afraid of? I know you don't call your daddy. Daddy's afraid of spiders, too.
Run away.
Run away. Well, you know, sometimes we can't run away from our fears. Does anybody else have fears? Mm-hmm. What's your fear?
Snakes.
Snakes. Anybody else?
Height.
Height. What a brave bunch we are.
Driving over bridges.
Oh, driving over bridges. Don't go to Chesapeake Bay Tunnel Bridge. We all have different kind of fears, but you know what? We all can't run away from them. And Scripture tells us we have to be courageous. What does that mean? Be courageous. You don't know. What's being courageous mean?
Brave.
Brave. Brave. Can you be brave?
Kind of.
You know what? You do something that I would not like to do, and that is, you're the chicken girl. She raises chickens. And you pick up those things, don't you?
Yep.
Would you like to pick up a chicken? Anybody want to volunteer?
No.
Yeah, I don't want to pick up chickens. So in that respect, you're brave already. And you know what? Chicken is bigger than a spider. So you don't need to be afraid of spiders, okay? Scripture tells us we are to be brave, to be courageous, and to be strong. And you know how we can do that? When we ask God for help. Okay? Can you remember that?
I think.
Yeah, you think. Okay, be brave, be courageous, go back to your seat. As we come to our time of prayers this morning, we have several. We already heard about Ruth is doing well from her hip replacement on Wednesday. Valerie had her hip replacement on Thursday. We're running a special. Jeff had his eye surgery and is doing well. And then I got a message that said that everybody in the household came down with COVID.
Oh.
So Jeff is still negative, but he moved out of the house. He was living with us, staying with his sister. So not only did he have to fly to Oregon to get the surgery, now he had to leave his sister's house and he went to his brother's. But of course, you don't want anybody in your house that was exposed to COVID, so he's living in their camper. So Jeff is going to have a wonderful story when all this is over. But Jeff is doing well. His surgery has taken so far. So continued prayers for Jeff. You know, this is like the third surgery to repair this. So continued prayers for him. Viola McGuigan has been moved into the landing, which is on Yardville Highland Square Road here. She's not a happy camper. So continued prayers for her as well. For Len Pope with low blood pressure. For Lisa, low platelets and white cells, stopping one of her chemo drugs. And just continue prayers for her as she goes through that. You heard on the prayer chain this week that Ricky Hussein got trampled by a horse. She has three fractures in her shoulder, has a lot of pain. So prayers for Ricky. And Julie Finelli, coming home today from the hospital with low platelets as well. She was in for transfusions. We had a lot going on here.
Yeah.
Prayers of comfort for Ronnie and Wes in the passing of Ronnie's mother on Friday.
Our Heavenly Father, we bow before you this day in gratitude, O God, that you have called us to be together in this place. We thank you, O God, for calling us as a people of faith who can gather together not only to worship you, but to pray on behalf of those in need of prayer this day. Lord, we remember those who need your continued healing in their lives, for Ruth and for Valerie, for Jeff, for Viola McGuigan, for Lisa Malazzo, for Len Pope, for Ricky Hussein, for Julie Finella. Many others, oh God, you know who needs your healing touch in their lives. We continue to remember Jim, oh God, in hospice, yet coming alive so he can speak with his family and enjoy his time with them. Lord, many others, as we saw with our dedication this day, Lord, are in need of physical things. Lord, so we pray that those poverty packs would go to women and young girls to make their lives easier for each time of their month. Make them feel like a human once again. And we pray, oh God, that we would continue to remember those in our community who are seeking employment, those who are still without homes. Lord, that you, oh God, would speak to us and move us in their direction when needed. We remember, oh God, many who have hidden prayers. Prayers that are so deep, oh Lord, they cannot share them aloud. But we know, God, that you hear each and every one that's in our hearts. We are grateful, oh God, this day to have a wonderful speaker and a woman of God before us, Lord. As we listen to her words, Lord, we pray for encouragement for each of us. Lord, give us strength. Give us encouragement, Lord, and make us into the people that you would have us be in this place. Never forgetting, oh God, how blessed we are. And how much, oh God, we can share with the world. So hear us this day. Continue to teach us and send us forth as a changed people to change the world around us. For we pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
The scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians. The 16th chapter, verses 13 and 14. Be on your guard, stand firm in every faith. Be courageous, be strong, do everything in love.
Amen.
Here ends the Lord's reading.
Our guest today is Reverend Dr. Gina Jacob Strain. Gina has loved the Lord since she was a child and gave her life to Christ in elementary school. Gina earned her bachelor's at Rutgers, her Master of Divinity at Drew University Theological School, and in May of 2020, she received her Doctorate of Ministry from Duke University. She has served as pastor to several churches in North Jersey, is a contributing author to Testify, ABCNJ Devotional. She launched a Christian educational series entitled Leading Interactive and Engaging Bible Studies. Also created the conversational series, The Intersection of Leadership and Healing. Reverend Gina currently serves as the executive director of our American Baptist Women's Missions Ministries. I always get that confused. Ministries, which is housed in Valley Forge. That's where the office is. And Gina enjoys facilitating and inspiring Christian educators to share the Word of God, helping teachers and students to discover the application of God's Word in their everyday lives. What a wonderful thing. It has been my privilege to meet Gina quite a few years ago through ABWM. And over the past 6 years, it's been, Gina, we have attended meetings together and events in person and virtually, as well as served on committees together. It is my privilege, and I'm very happy to welcome Dr. Gina Jacob Strain to Memorial's pulpit on this American Baptist Woman's Sunday. Gina, please.
Thank you, Sue. Good morning, and to God be the glory.
Amen.
It is good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
There are many places we could be today, but it is good to be in the house of the Lord. I thank your pastor, Reverend April Van Ness, for inviting me to be with you today. I thank you for everyone that is present here. And I have to say that many years ago, I came here with D.D. Turlington, one of my first ABWM events. When I worked for American Baptist Churches, New Jersey, D.D. invited me to lunch, and she was funny. She said, well, I know you don't have much of a budget, so I'm going to invite you to lunch, and lunch is on me. And so we went to lunch, and then she said, you need to get to know more. I was serving as the associate regional director for American Baptist Women in Ministry. And she said, well, you need to get to know more of American Baptist Women's Ministries. Who knew then what she was preparing me for? But God knew. Amen? And so I came here for an event, and it was my first event, and I stayed for lunch. And so it was really quite lovely, and throughout the years, Dee Dee was always so very, very helpful to me, inviting me to her church to preach, hosting women in ministry events, and certainly she is missed because she poured into the lives of so many, many people when she was pastor, and even when she was in Florida and beyond. And so I am truly grateful to have known her. Sue and I work on a lot of committees together, and Sue can make anything fun. When you can have to go through 120 pages of a Here's How document, which is the guide for American Baptist Women's Ministries boards.
Wow.
We did not have a single meeting where we did not laugh. And Sue is also a wordsmith. We would think we were done with a paragraph, and she'd go back and say, no, I really think that word should be is and not this, and I think we need to rework this here. And we say, okay, we're going to rework it, and we put in another draft. But it is great to be able to have someone that you can count on. So not only has she served faithfully as your ABWM president in New Jersey, she has served the board faithfully. And often, as a executive director, I get the privilege of staffing many committees. Not all committees are fun, but I do know that if Sue's going to be on the committee, it is going to be a good committee. Amen?
Amen.
I'm happy to learn about your projects here and your connection to a local high school, and it's just nice to be with you again today. I brought with me today my good friend Elaine Cody, who also wrote with me many Bible studies, and we've worked a lot together over the years. And then my husband, who if you see him squinting, is because I have on his glasses. I left mine at home. I have glasses everywhere in my house. Usually two or three pairs in my pocketbook, a pair on my head and usually a pair on my face. We get in the car, I'm carrying a pocketbook that I don't normally carry, and I say, I left my glasses at home. And he, as being such a nice husband, gave me his. So praise the Lord that we wear the same strength. You know, I never understood when my grandparents would be swapping glasses and swapping medicines, and I would say, that's just crazy. Who does that? Well, if you live long enough, you find you may do some of the same things that your grandparents did. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Most gracious and awesome God, we do thank you for this day. We thank you that you are a God of abundance, that you are a God of joy, that you are a God of healing. You are a God that opens doors. And so now, Lord, I ask you that you hide me behind the cross and that you allow the blood of Jesus to cover me. Lord, let all that I have prepared only be said if it honors you, for I am your servant. And I am nothing without you. And so, God, I come humbly before you, asking you to be with me and prepare hearts and minds to receive, Lord, only what you would have me say. I pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. So my sermon title is God is Thinking of Us, ... So be strong and be courageous. And I want you to know that being strong and being courageous may not look exactly as you imagine it. It may not be in the way that you are thinking. And so first and foremost, in being strong and being courageous, we need to consult God so that we are prepared to be strong and courageous. I was at a women's conference yesterday, and I sat in on a workshop called Transformation, Making Room for Millennials and Gen Zers. And as I looked around the room, I noticed there were very few millennials and Gen Zers in the room. And someone said, well, we just want to invite in the kids, and we just want to invite them in to be with us and to pray with us and to do all these things that they were listing. And a very lovely Gen Zer who was leading the workshop said, well, first of all, we are no longer kids. We are now between the ages of 27 and 42, born in 1981 to 1996. So that was changing the conversation right there. We are no longer kids, and so you can't just invite us in for a moment, but you must make space for us because we have jobs, we have families, we have responsibilities. And so being strong and being courageous with love may look a little different. Every generation has something that defines them. And when we look around our churches, the two groups that we see that are most often empty, or absent, I should say, are the Gen Zers and the millennials, right? I saw a headline of an article about millennials, and it said, we are not skipping church, but church is skipping us. And that's a lot to swallow. So this be strong, be courageous for ABWM in this era is calling for us to be something slightly different. You see, Sunday mornings, our churches can be robust. They can be packed. We can have wonderful worship. We can have wonderful choirs. But when we look around at our average church in the American Baptist Church, and the average age is probably well over 70. And so while we may look robust, we are on the decline without millennials and Gen Zers. And so we have to remember now that Gen Zers, and I have a Gen Zer at home who is very honest to tell me when things are right and when things are wrong. Since he was a little kid, he would do this when I finished preaching. And so this sideways meant that I had mispronounced something, or maybe I mentioned somebody on a basketball team, but I put them on the wrong team, or maybe I mentioned somebody on a football team, and I put them on the wrong football team. He said, you know, Mom, they were traded. They're no longer on that team. You know, and I'd say to him, you don't have to tell me, like, right after the service. You know, you can wait till we get home. You don't have to give me if it's a thumbs up, you can do that. But you don't have to give me the sideways one if there's something. Or that meant he had a question, right? They are very honest, and they want you to be authentic. They require us to be transparent, right? In ways that sometimes our generation and the generation certainly of my grandparents was not always so willing to be transparent. This is, the Gen Zers have lived under the constant threat of terrorism, wars all around them, COVID, school closings, no graduation, no proms, no sports, missing many rites of passage, and it has shaped them differently. School shootings and technology at their fingertips, and now AI is on the rise, mm-hmm. and who knows? You know, we have a workshop coming up in Ohio, and one of our millennials said, well, I'm going to talk to the girls about AI. I said, oh, no, we are not going to have those parents blaming us later for the girls having AI do their homework. I said, so we can talk to them about it, but I don't know that we want to give a demonstration of it, mm-hmm. because there is some worry about what AI can do and how AI will be used. And then they just, you know, these Gen Zers, they embrace technology. We learned the Bible horizontally. They've learned it vertically on their phones, on their tablets. It's a different way, but it is the same God. And it is the same Bible. And it is the same word. And our millennials are the largest living generation. They are also the most educated and have the highest school debt. Coming out of college, coming out of seminary with hundreds of thousands of dollars of debt. They are also the largest renting generation in the history of our country. And what it costs to go to school now feels like it should be illegal.
Yeah. Amen.
It is unbelievable. And I keep saying to my kids, the older I get, that I want my money back that I paid for school, because now I'm going to need it when it's time for me to retire, but it's gone. And there's so much debt that our young people take on. And so being courageous and being strong means that we have got to care about the issues that are important to young people. We've got to care about housing. We've got to care about what's happening in our community. We have to care about education costs. It was a time where going to a community college would save you some money and then you could transfer to a four-year college, but you go look up a community college right now. It is expensive. But we care because we are Jesus people, right? We are Jesus people. We are Christians. We do what we do because we love the Lord. And so with all the differences, we must embrace their brilliance and their trauma. We must know that God is coming back for the whole church, not just a part of the church, and not just the things that we are comfortable with. And so we must be busy in this space of being strong and being courageous. It requires us to follow the movement of God, and we want our actions rooted in love, and we also want to be wise. James says, but the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. So we want to be strong, we want to be wise, and we want to be peacemakers. Now, 1 Corinthians is really a story that everyone and every Christian needs in their toolkit. We all need this because it is about a church that is in the midst of struggles. And it is just as relevant then as it is now. And we know that God provides for every situation, for every dilemma, for every challenge we face, for every opportunity we have, for every trial that turns into a triumph, for every loss that may not be a loss in the eyes of God, and for every victory that we have that may not be an absolute win. But whatever we face, we know that God is thinking of us. So if you would just look at your neighbor and say, God is thinking of us.
God is thinking of us.
And now look at your other neighbor and say, I am the church. And so are you. And so in this, we hear, by the time Paul gets to 16, he says, be on your guard, stand firm, be courageous, be strong, do everything in love. Not some things, not just the things for the people we like, not just the things for the people in our community, but everything in love. John 13:35 tells us, "But this everyone will know that you are disciples if you love one another." I that familiar song that says our love, it says our love, by our love we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and I pray that our unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they will know that we are Christians. We will guard each other's dignity and save each other's pride, and they will know that we are Christians by our love. This love thing is serious. And all of 1 Corinthians is instruction for the church then and now. It is a story about a church struggling and trying to figure out how to live with God in community. Paul is a bit frustrated, if you go back to the beginning of this chapter, and concerned that the church that he planted is not mature in their faith. And so after much instruction and encouragement, he comes to this chapter 16. The church is struggling with the same issues that we struggle with today, both inside and outside the church and in the world. Spiritual immaturity, lack of equity, apathy, doctrine and tradition over the gospel. It is the issues that we see all around us of power and elitism and greed over ethics, justice, and inclusion. There are divisions because the people are picking spiritual leaders. I didn't say they were picking Jesus. I said they are picking spiritual leaders in this text. And so there are thorny disagreements about the right kind of community worship, about what is supposed to happen in community, about the proper use of spiritual gifts. Some scholars say that 1 Corinthians is a nitty-gritty document written to a church struggling to discover the boundaries and fullness of its life with God. With God and in community is difficult. You know, in our prayer closets, in my quiet time, in my when I am being a prayer warrior and it's just me and Jesus, oh, everything is good. But when we have to step out of the prayer closet and live in the reality of life, live in community where everything that you told Jesus you are going to do, now you have a chance to do, it can be a little more complicated. And so Paul addresses division multiple times in this chapter. Paul is frustrated with the church that he has planted. He says, some of you claim that I baptized you. Some of you claim Apollos. Some of you claim Cephas. And some follow Christ. He said, but Jesus is not divided, and none of us were crucified for you. None of us were resurrected for you. And then he says, were you baptized in my name? He's speaking to the lack of unity and the confusion and the arguments that they are having. And he goes on to say, this is a slight paraphrase, I'm glad I didn't baptize any of you. Oh, wait, except, Crispus and Gaius. No, wait. I think I also baptized the household of Stephanus. Beyond that, I don't remember who I baptized. He is really frustrated. And when I read this text, I laugh, because imagine that. Church people making you frustrated. Imagine that, okay? He says, but I came here to share the gospel. He's frustrated, but he's not set aside. He's frustrated by the bickering and the small-mindedness, but he's not defeated. There's a song that Marvin Gaye wrote that's called Inner City Blues, and he said, sometimes people make you want to holler and just throw up both your hands. And I feel like that's where we find Paul. He is sad about the lack of faith, sad about the lack of maturity, and the gap between his deep desire for every believer to experience the transforming love and grace of Jesus and where they are. He's frustrated, but he keeps on urging them that this life with God, you can be transformed. And he points out in this letter the importance of them being continued dialogue amongst leaders, the need for fellowship within the church. We are reminded that all of us, not some of us, but all of us are supposed to nurture and have fellowship with one another. We are supposed to build each other up and stand firm in the faith and do all things. All things in love. Paul is trying to set things right by keeping the focus on Jesus, on our resurrection God, on the Savior. He is trying to help us understand that we cannot have disagreements that then become the focus of our being together, because we have broken fellowship when that happens. And we as the body of Christ must be preparing for Christ to return. We must be preparing the full body with God. With God. We want to live in community, and we want there to be evidence that we are Christians. We want people to know that there's something about us, something good about us that they might want to have a part of. Whenever I have to go to motor vehicle, I remember that I am a Christian. And that I could easily run into somebody in the parking lot or in the place. So Lord Jesus, be with me today and help me to exercise wisdom and discernment and love. This year, American Baptist Women's Ministry kicked off our two-year ministry theme. For 2023 to 2025, it is Be Strong, Be Courageous. And this ministry focus will guide our ministries, our programming, our use of our resources for a two-year period. In 2019 through 2021, after much prayer and discussion, the board decided that the ministry focus would be Sisters Seeking Wholeness. During this time, our Bible studies, webinar series, conferences, and everything was centered on wellness and wholeness. And in 21 to 23, the board selected a new exciting ministry focus called Let the Walls Fall Down. You see, there was an understanding that there was a need to remove internal and external, spiritual, emotional, physical roadblocks, strongholds, and spiritual walls that keep us divided and disconnected as the body of Christ. We are creating spaces for a better today and future for ABWM. We as women of God decided to live with God in community with love in our churches, our communities, our families. We are passionate about removing walls that blocked our wholeness, our holiness, and our wellness collectively and individually. We are a Christ-centered sisterhood engaging and empowering women from the inside out. We are prayerfully determined that our 32 regions will enjoy a sisterhood that is growing deeper in our individual and collective spiritual and faith journeys. We know that it is essential that we are aligned, transparent, unified, respectful, discerning, and persistent in love, grace, justice, and mercy. Not easy, but like Paul, we are pressing on. And with these ideals in mind, the National Board moved our 32 regions forward with this new theme in 2022 through 2025, Be Strong, Be Courageous. Because it is not enough just to let the walls don't come down. Now we have to be strong and be courageous in our love as we embrace all of God's gifts and all of God's women. We truly seek to be an intergenerational, diverse ministry. In addition to our big ministry themes, we have an annual mission theme. Last year it was Real Acceptance. And women all over the U.S. shared with us what real acceptance meant to them. And equally this year, we picked racial justice. Now, so interesting that these one-year themes are often picked 3-4 years in advance. So who knew where we would be in our country when we picked some of these things? When we picked Sisters Seeking Wholeness, we didn't know we were about to be on the cusp of the Me Too movement and the Church Too movement that would follow right there. But God knew, because God was thinking of us. We did not know when we had real acceptance followed by racial justice that our country would still be so divided by race. But God knew. And God, now more than ever, God has called us to say, be guarded, stand firm in the faith, be strong, be courageous, and do everything with love. Each of us will, or we already have, our own story, our own testimony, our own workplace, our own opportunity to be strong and courageous for Jesus. And it may not be something that you are passionate about. It may be that you have to defend an enemy. It may be that you have to defend someone that you don't like. It may be that you have to step in the shoes and into the reality of someone you have never met. Be strong and be courageous may not be comfortable. It may be something quite different. In order for us to be a united body of Christ, in order for the church to be ready for when God comes back. But if we desire to show the characteristics of God, then we must be ready to be strong and to be courageous. We must be ready to walk shoulder to shoulder and be connected heart to heart in God's call to share the gospel, and even more so, to be the gospel. We must be consistent with Joshua 1:9. It says God has commanded us to be strong and be courageous, and we will not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord is with us wherever we go. I'm reminded of Philippians. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus. Be guarded. Be aware and discerning so that division does not sneak in. Be prayerful so that nonsense does not become your focus and disagreements just for the sake of being right. I heard a seasoned Christian say just recently that some churches are more focused on existing than sharing the gospel. Be guarded, be aware, be rooted in the word of God so that we can have the characteristics of God. And guard yourselves, guard ourselves. Guard our young people against pride and anger and selfishness and unforgiveness and ego. Little word, big problem. Rebuke the enemy and stay away from trouble. Some of us know trouble when we see it. Some of us have people in our lives that shouldn't be in our lives, because with them comes trouble. Sometimes the devil has purposely put things in your lives because the devil knows what God has planned for you and tries to throw you off your game, but stay connected. Be guarded and stay connected to God. We want our lives to be witnesses. Surrender the flesh and submit everything to God. Lean in to Jesus and lean away from division. Stand firm. Know the word of God. For every situation we face, everything you could think about is in the Bible. Good thing, bad thing, funny thing, awkward thing, complicated thing, it is in the word of God. There is truly nothing new under the sun. Amen. AI may be new to us, but Jesus knew it was coming a long time ago. So be rooted and know the word of God, because Jesus is with us. Stand firm, stand firm. You know, sometimes we doubt Jesus. God has done so many things for us. When we look back, put your mind on rewind and you look back over how you made it through certain things or gifts and blessings that you have, and it's shocking. And yet and still, sometimes we doubt Jesus. This is kind of a funny example, but I want to say that when you hear the Mrs. Softy music or you hear the good humor music, you know that ice cream is coming. You're not thinking about whatever problem you might have in that moment, and I don't care if you're 6 or 66. When you hear the Mr. Softy music or you hear the good humor music, you know that ice cream is coming. And you go to that truck already with what you have in mind. Jesus is better than ice cream. And Jesus is a sure thing. And so if we can have that kind of joy, or that kind of anticipation just when we hear the music. Last year when we had our women's conference in King of Prussia, we had an ice cream truck come one night. And I don't know if this is going to go over well, because it was 90 degrees in the evening. And the truck was supposed to come at 4 and somehow got a little mixed up, and he came after dinner, after the evening worship. So he got there about 8 o'clock. There was not a single person who did not get ice cream. And the faces of people, there was one guy who said, he said, well, can I have 2 scoops? And we said, yeah. He said, well, can I have them, you know, can they be dipped in different things? The guy said, yes. He said, this is the best. He says, my whole life, I've been waiting to have a double scoop with 2 different kinds of toppings on it. Who knew that this would be such an exciting and wonderful thing? And everyone, now not everybody stayed outside and ate their ice cream. But everybody knew that Mr. Softy, and when they saw the truck and they heard the music, because he played the music as he came in, people said, we're having ice cream? we didn't even tell them. We're having ice cream? Yes, we are. Okay. Outside they went. We were working on our packages and our gifts that we were giving to a domestic shelter. People said, we will be back. We will be back. We are going out for the ice cream truck. Jesus is better than ice cream. Be strong against false teachings and divisiveness. Be strong against anything that breaks the fellowship of the church. We are to be in relationship with each other, lifting each other up, not tearing each other down. Have the strength and conviction to stand for equity and kindness and care for all people.
Amen.
Be courageous in the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, what God is asking us to do, we cannot do in the natural. We can't do it on our own. No matter how brilliant we are, no matter how creative we are, no matter how many great ideas that we have. And so for me, whenever I see the words everything or all or everyone and always, that is a shouting moment for me. I can do all things through Christ because I know it's not about me. Christ is all and all are in Christ. I know that that means that I've got to lean on the Holy Spirit because that is the only way we can do everything in love. But all too often we engage life without prayer and preparation and without God, and then we call God to fix what we have messed up. There is no better source of ideas, no better solutions than the ones that are inspired by the Holy Spirit. Be strong, be courageous. May not look like what we expected to do, but we have to do it all in love. 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, love, now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Love. When Jesus was asked, teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is a Holy Spirit moment. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Oh, this love thing is serious. Because even when we get to Luke 35, 36, it says, but love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great and you will be children of the Most High. Here's the kicker for me. Because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. That's the God that we serve. That is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. So be merciful just as your Father is merciful. God is thinking of you. Not sometimes. Not only when you're thinking about God, but all the time. Not only when God wakes you up in the morning, but God remembers us mere mortals because he has made us so that we may have an abundant life. God is thinking about the church, and God is coming back for the church. God is coming back for a united people. God is coming back, and God is expecting us to look like Christians. God is expecting us to act like Christians. God is expecting us to know who is missing and who is not there and to make space, real space. We can't invite millennials and Gen Zers in and tell them how to do things. I have two millennials and one Gen Zer, and they are always telling me how to do things. And they have stretched me, and they have helped us grow, and they have helped us see that we cannot always see the world in one way. Pray, pray, pray. Because we have the blessed assurance that Jesus is ours. Pray. Do what you can and God will do the rest. And the rest that God will do is the best. Trust in the power of the Holy Spirit. Not in your power, but in the power of God. Trust in the power of Jehovah Shalom. Trust in the power of Jehovah Nisi. Trust in the power of Jehovah Rapha. Trust in the power of the great I am. God is thinking of us. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. Rejoice in AB Women's Day. Amen.
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 And all the people said,
Amen.
Gina, I can't thank you enough. I see Gina on Zoom, and it's just great to be able to see her in person. You know, you see these people, but you don't get to meet them. Thank you so much. Gina has left us with a lot to think about, a lot to do, a lot of work to do, people. We just can't leave here and forget about it. Thank you so much. And before we sing our last song, I would like to invite all the women, Gina and friends and family, downstairs for lunch. Funniest thing, we're going to have ice cream. This is the second thing this week that has revolved around ice cream after we had decided that that was going to be our dessert. Don't tell me God is not with us all the time and fooling around with us. Before we close today, I want to thank Sharon. Sharon puts this all together. She brings us all out of our shells and gets people to do things they've never done. Great job, Sharon. Thank you so much. You're not going to get out of this too easy, so shall we pray? Dear Lord, we just cannot thank you enough for the opportunity that we have to serve you, to leave this building and go out and share your love with others. Please help each and every one of us to be strong and courageous and to step out in faith. In your name we pray. Amen.